Welcome to Cub Programming 2020. My name is Susan Hensley, and today we're going to be doing Webelos First Responder. What is First Responder, you might ask? Well, that's another way of saying first aid. The reason why we're doing Cub Programming 2020 is that right now we're all confined to home because of the virus COVID-19. Well, this program is a way for Cub Scouts and their leaders to be able to continue providing the great fun and adventure for Cub Scouting while still being safe at home. Now, for those of you who are just joining Scouting or just starting the Webelos program, you probably want to get this book. It's called the Webelos Cub Scout Handbook. Take some time with your parent or a guardian and review the first section of it so that you have an understanding what Webelos is all about. Webelos is a very special time because when you finish with the Webelos program, when you're in about fifth grade or so, that's when you'll be transitioning to Scouts BSA and be able to do even more fun scouting program. So how will this program work today, what we're going to do? Well, it's part of a blended learning process. First of all, you and your parent or adult guardian, are going to be reading the first responder section in your Webelos handbook. Now, attached to this video, there is like a little syllabus or lesson plan that perhaps your den leader, if you are having regular den meetings, would want to refer to in order to make sure you guys have all that fun within your own den meeting, as well as learning all about first aid. After you've done all this reading, then you're going to be doing some exercises. Now, these exercises are games and fun things to do, so I think you're going to really like this. And once you've completed all of this for each section, please go to page 501 in your Webelos handbook and have your leader or your parent, in this case, sign off on this, saying that you have completed each of the requirements for the first responder. Take that information or send that information to your advancement chairman in your Cub Pack so they can make sure that it's appropriately logged in. What we're going to do for this particular video segment today are three things that I think are a little bit hard to learn just by reading your book. So we're going to go over severe bleeding. We're going to review conscious choking. And then finally, we're going to be doing heart attack or sudden cardiac arrest and stopped breathing. I'll talk to you a little while after we do these demonstrations. Welcome back. What we're going to do now is talk about how to manage severe bleeding. You may or may not be aware that inside our bodies, we have tubes, blood vessels, and these blood vessels take blood from our heart to the various parts of our body and back again. If a blood vessel, they pretty much look like this. Some of them are smaller and some of them are bigger, but essentially looks like a red tube. We're going to pretend that my husband David has gotten a severe cut on his arm. This could be anybody, but whenever you're going to be dealing with blood or any kind of body fluid, you want to make sure as a first responder that you're protecting yourself. So you want to put on your gloves. And then, if the blood is squirting, which it can do, especially if the cut is deep, you want to make sure that you put on your protective eyewear. To stop the blood would be very much like putting a kink in a garden hose. So you want to put some pressure down on the blood vessel that's running to and from the heart. So what you do is that you take a gauze, and you put it over the wound and you apply direct pressure. Keep it there. Don't rush. If there's a lot of bleeding, it may be that you might need a second dressing. But don't peek. Grab some more gauze and put it right on top of the other gauze and press down firmly. This will help the blood flow that's going through the blood vessel to slow down and eventually stop bleeding. In order to secure the bandage, the best way to do, again, don't peek, is to use a rolled gauze. You could also use your neckerchief. You take the gauze and you would place it over the wound, and you'd give it a few wraps around the gauze. Make sure it's nice and firm and secure. When you get about to where you want to be, grab it and start going back the other direction. Now, with a pair of scissors, you'd want to cut the gauze, of course, with your third hand. And tie the dressing off, probably using a good, strong scout knot. At this point, you would want to continue to assess your victim. Perhaps you would want to put him in the recovery position or treat him for shock, because he's lost a lot of blood. So if that's the case, you would make sure that your victim was able to lie down and then elevate their feet. But that's something we will do in another exercise. In this segment, what we're going to be reviewing is the conscious choking victim. Typically, if someone is choking, they're no longer able to cough or laugh or talk. And often they'll have their hands around their neck. Are you okay? Are you okay? Are you choking? I know CPR. I can help you. What you're first going to do is you're going to have the victim bend over and you're going to hit them between their shoulder blade firmly with the heel portion of your hand. Do this 5 times. 4, 5. You then, what you're going to do is to get behind them and just above their belly button, kind of in the bread basket area, you're going to put your fist, thumb side in, put the other hand over it, and push in and up. In and up. Do this 5 times. And if that doesn't relieve the object that is caught in their throat, then you're going to have them bend over and you're going to give them the back blows 5 times. You notice that I'm not doing this hard because I could really hurt my victim here. But if it was for real, you would definitely need to hit very firmly and to squeeze in the old belly very, very firmly in and up. Keep doing that. In the meantime, you want to make sure that someone has called 911 or the emergency number. And then, even if the object does become dislodged and the victim is able to breathe and cough again, then what you need to do is to make sure the victim continues to proceed to receive medical care, because the throat can still continue to swell up, or there still may be pieces of the foreign object caught in their throat. We're now going to talk about sudden cardiac arrest, okay, or a heart attack. If someone is having chest pain, shoulders, arm pain that radiate to the arm, to the back, or up into the jaw, particularly on the left side or in the middle, you want to make sure that this person accesses care. They will probably be in denial that they might be having a heart attack. Should this person, should you come across this person, and you don't know what happened, then you need to make sure that the scene is safe for you to even enter. So we're going to start a scenario. Remember, if you've read your book, track the scene, track the victim, don't forget to stay calm, okay? Then you're going to call for help, and then you're going to render care. So, we're about ready to start now with our victim that we find on the ground. We've checked the scene already. Are you okay? Are you okay? You, go call 911. Tell them that we have an unconscious victim, and then come back here. You're going to open up the airway by tilting the head back, and you're going to listen and feel for any signs of life. You're going to do this for 5 to 10 seconds. 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. There is no sign of life. There has been no pulse. So the first thing I'm going to do is to pull out my face mask, put on my gloves if I haven't already done that. The face mask is going to look something like this, but perhaps you have something fancier. It will go over the victim's nose and mouth. And this hooks behind the ears. You are then going to be giving chest compressions by putting the heel of your hand right in the middle of the breastbone, interlacing your fingers, and with straight elbows and shoulders, you're going to squeeze down 1.5 to 2 inches. I'm not going to do that right now because it might hurt him, but in a second, I'll show you what we would do. You're going to do this 30 times. 1, 2, 3, 4. 5 and 6 and 7 and 8 and 9 and 10 and 11 and 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30. Keeping the head tilted back, you're going to pinch the victim's nose, open up the jaw with the other hand, and breathe 2 times. And about 1 second per breath, and then you're going to redo 30 times. And we will pause, and I'll switch with a tennis ball, show you what this all is going to look like. Now what you're going to do to practice is you will never be compressing on anybody's chest, but what you can do is that you can use a couple of pillows, or you can use a tennis ball to practice the squeezing portion. So let me show you how that would work if all you have are pillows. You interlace your fingers, elbows straight, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30. Breathe. Breathe. You can also use a tennis ball. Same thing. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and so on. So make sure that you never cause any damage to or injury to any of your pretend victims that you're doing here while we are practicing for your Webelos first responder. For those of you who have been following along, good job. You might want to do some more practice, so keep practicing. However, in scouting, this is not your only opportunity to practice first aid. When you transition over to Scouts BSA, you will have an opportunity not only to practice first aid as part of your rank advancement, but also we have a first aid merit badge book. And you'll find that to be very, very interesting and a whole lot of fun. Okay. Don't forget that There are still lots of things as a Webelos and Cub Scout that you can do. So make sure you keep tabs with the council website. Find out all the exciting things that are available, even during these trying times. Stay safe. And remember the Cub Scout motto, do your best.